have osteoporosis, and more than 700,000 vertebral compression fractures are reported each year. And there is a great economic impact of these vertebral fractures. So these vertebral compression fractures can be insidious. That is the basic thing which we are worried about. They are not always apparent and not always stable. And they tend to progress over time, and they may have devastating consequences, especially the neurological complications later on. So this vertebral augmentation, or cementoplasty as it is known, contains a gamut of procedures, right from vertebroplasty, which is injection of PMMA bone cement into the vertebral body, to kyphoplasty, which is injection after manipulation and involving a cavity creation. Then we have something called spinoplasty, then there is pediculoplasty, sacroplasty, and these days we are also using cement augmented screws in the osteoporotic spine, in which we use cannulated and fenestrated screws. But these are beyond the scope of this talk, so we'll be focusing on kyphoplasty only. So the pain in vertebral compression fractures is seen in conditions like primary osteoporosis, steroid-induced osteoporosis, neoplastic-induced fractures, traumatic collapse, vertebral angiomas, symptomatic microfractures, and lytic lesions in the CT without loss of vertebral height. So even without an obvious loss of vertebral height, the patient may be symptomatic. This obvious loss of height may not be apparent on the X-ray. So we need to do some higher investigative modalities like a CT or an MRI. So here you can see a subtle fracture, but on a CT or an MRI, it is quite apparent. So this is a traditional conservative therapy, and still this is the first line, which consists of NSAIDs, opioids, muscle relaxants, bed rest, orthotic bracing. And with this, the compression fracture should heal in about 6 to 12 weeks. But 15 to 20% of the patients are refractory. The traditional management can itself has its side effects, like analgesics. They have a temporary, they give temporary relief. They have their associated side effects. Bed rest prolonged can lead to DVT or pneumonia. Then problem of immobilization. And surgery in these situations is always challenging because the screws tend to give way. And even with this traditional management, around 15 to 20% So this is the kyphoplastic deformity and not the acute back pain, which accounts for long-term consequences. And this is the downward spiral in these cases. The vertebral compression fracture leads to a back pain. Then it leads to a spinal deformity, depleting the lung capacity, followed by an impaired function, loss of appetite, and so on. And these patients tend to have up to 23% increased mortality. So this is the reason why. So you can see, as the lever arm due to the kyphotic fracture increases, the pressure on the forward bending moment on the spine increases. And up to 5-fold increase of a subsequent spine fracture is there with these patients. And once a vertebral compression fracture has occurred, there is a risk of an additional fracture. It is 5 times more likely. If there are 2 or more fractures in the first instance, it is 12 times more likely and may rise up to 75 times more likely. The vital capacity of these patients and post-expiratory volume also tend to be less. So this is the mechanical effect of the kyphosis on the osteoporotic spine, the aging spine. There is an increased vertical stress. There is an increased static stress. There is a decreased thoracic space and abdominal space. There is a center of gravity shift and a compensatory stance, which leads to joint stress, paraspinal muscle fatigue, hamstring foreshortening. All these contribute to the pain in the back. So there is a profound impact of radiographically detected vertebral compression fractures. There is increasingly linked to the COPD, the cardiac diseases, and even stroke and cancer. there is a higher mortality rate in such patients. So the basic principles of any fracture management, we are talking about the osteoporotic vertebral compression fracture. The basic principles of any fracture management is, first of all, fracture reduction, then fracture fixation, and then preservation and early mobilization. And all these goals may not be met by the conservative management or even vertebroplasty. So this is how a balloon, it elevates the end plates in the vertebral compression fracture. The force created by the balloon in the small cavity tends to lift up the end plate and causes fracture reduction. So the balloon in the bone creates enough force to reduce this fracture. We will see all this in detail subsequently. And this causes a reduction. So this is the summary of the process which happens when we tend to use the balloon to reduce these fractures. The bone gets compacted outwards and into the porous spaces. The tamp inflation displaces and compacts the cancellous bone. The cancellous bone gets stiffens and moves as a mass, transferring the force to the surrounding cortex and lifting up the cortex. And the cortex then moves back to its normal configuration, increasing the height of the end plates. And they tend to become more parallel. So in the short term, the results of balloon kyphoplasty leads to a reduction in the back pain, increase in the quality of life, improvement in mobility. And in the long term, there is sustained reduction of pain, sustained quality of life, and it maintains this improvement for a longer duration. Apart from the osteoporotic fractures, we use these techniques, the vertebroplasty, in compression fractures due to a primary neoplasm, hemangioma or a myeloma. In the secondary cases of metastasis and malignant lymphomas of the bone. Yes. So, is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, the vertebral, there is some absolute contraindication for these procedures. This is an asymptomatic compression fracture. There is no business of doing a procedure in an asymptomatic compression fracture. Any active osteomyelitis of the target vertebra, any allergy to the bone cement, or an uncorrectable coagulopathy. All these are absolute contraindications. And these are some relative contraindications, such as a radiculopathy, which is unrelated to this fractured segment. Retropurulsion of the fragment in a severe canal compromise, a tumor extension into canal, or a systemic infection. If the patient is improving on medical therapy, we tend to continue the conservative treatment. We normally do not use it as a prophylaxis in the osteoporotic spine, and if there is myelopathy at fracture level. So the objectives of the technique is to provide relief from a painful vertebra, to prevent further vertebral collapse that would lead to further loss of height and which results in a kyphosis and associated with fractures at the adjacent level. We also tend to use it as an early intervention to reduce the duration of pain and medication use and for rapid mobilization. And in the cases of occurrence of chronic back pain and to prevent a further collapse of the vertebra. So this is the patient selection criteria. It is used in painful fracture, which are increased on loading, not responding after 4 weeks of treatment, acute or subacute compression fracture on the brain radiograph or MRI, pain corresponding to level of the fracture. These are good patient selection criteria. So these are the patients who tend to respond best. Patients who have 1 to 3 levels of fractures. There's focal pain and tenderness which corresponds to the level on the imaging. The fracture is present for less than 2 months. There is recent worsening of the fracture, and there is no sclerosis of the fractured vertebra, which tends to indicate that it has healed in that place. And these are the poor patient selection criteria, and we should be aware while using and advocating such procedures in these patients. The patients who are less likely to respond are those who have a fracture present for more than a year. There are other causes of back pain and you are not able to localize according to the imaging lesion, such as disc herniation or a spinal stenosis, facet or a sacroiliac joint disease. These patients will not benefit with a kyphoplasty or a vertebroplasty. And there's a radicular pain which is related to a disc herniation. So the benefits are that it gives a quick pain relief and there's improved mobility. Patient is normally able to stand and walk within the first 24 hours. The success rate in neoplastic conditions is 70 to 92% and for osteoporosis is up to even 95%. So how does this technique elevate the pain and what is the theory behind it? Is that it stabilizes the fracture, the both the micro and the macro fractures. It acts as an internal splint. It allows the healing to occur. There is destruction of sensitive nerve endings and it prevents a further collapse. The tumors, it has been theorized, is there is the thermal toxic and the mass effect of the cement on the tumors. So it is a palliative procedure, but it does not correct the underlying cause. So the medical management of osteoporosis or malignancy must be initiated and continued, and do not think as a panacea. And that once the vertebroplasty or the kyphoplasty procedure has been done, you do not need to do anything further. This should be both in the physician's mind as well as the patient's mind. So how to go about this? So pre-procedure, we need to have some basic imaging, which is a X-ray and then magnetic resonance imaging or MRI with a T1, T2 and the STIR sequence to assess for a vertebral body marrow edema and excludes the stenosis due to disc or a facet disease. A CT scan may be used in some cases. So always think twice if you have a fracture above T6 level and it is less than patient is age is less than 55 years and there is no history of trauma. Patients with known malignancy. So be careful in these patients and do a proper thorough assessment before proceeding further. The age of the fracture should be taken into account and the history is the best indicator in such cases. From what period, from what time the history of the patient started, the pain started, that is the best indicator how old is the fracture. The plain films, the MRI we have discussed. The bone scan, most of us don't have access to it. This is just for theoretical completion. It has a 93% predictive value and may be abnormal even when an MRI is normal. So for really, really doubtful cases, one may even go for a bone scan. So the pre-procedure consultation includes an examination under the fluoroscopy and one very helpful imaging technique is a flexion and the extension X-ray. Here you can see that in the flexion X-ray, there is the vertebral collapse, which nicely opens up in the extension. So this clearly indicates that this is the unstable level. The fracture is not going into union and there is some kind of a pseudoarthrosis at this level and this is the target level. And needless to say, we should have an informed consent. So as I had mentioned earlier, the key to the success is the pain should be focal, intense, deep, local tenderness to the level corresponding with the imaging findings, and there should be no radiation to the legs. It should be a localized back pain and corresponding to your imaging. So you can discuss the procedure with the patient and obtain a consent. And maybe discuss these possible complications and keep this in mind when planning the case, such as bleeding, infection, fracture of the pedicle, damage to the nerve roots or spinal cord, worsening of the symptoms, pulmonary embolism and such. For treatment of potential complications, you should always have an immediate access to a CT scan or an MRI, an ICU and an operating room. So please, please, please do not treat this as a casual OPD procedure, but make everything ready. We need to have a high quality fluoroscopy. A fixed C-arm is beyond the scope of many of the practitioners. So normally, C-arm. the imaging, then these are the instruments and the table setting. And one tip I would recommend for everyone is to use lure lock syringes. So these are the lure lock syringes where there is a lock at the end of the syringe. These are readily available in the market, and these tend to lock onto your cannulas, and they don't tend to dislodge while pushing in the various dyes or the cement, etc. So these are very helpful. So the anesthesia can be intravenous, local, or general. Personally, I prefer to use local anesthesia, that is xylocaine with adrenaline and a mixture of bupivacaine for giving a prolonged effect even after the procedure is over. I normally tend to use one with adrenaline because it tends to control the local bleeding and makes the procedure a little less messy. So the basic advantage of using the local anesthesia for all these procedures is that you can communicate with the patient. The patient is awake and aware, and they themselves are a neuromonitoring onto themselves. You can diagnose early any complication which is happening. You can determine the speed of injection. You can anticipate any corrective maneuvers or when you want to abort the procedure if any complication is happening. So an awake patient would not let you proceed if any complication is happening. So preferably do these procedures under local anesthesia. So before the local anesthesia, you can pre-medicate the patient with an antibiotic of your choice. I tend to give an intramuscular Tramadol and IV diclofenac preparation and the injection of metoclopramide. Since the patient is prone, and patient is apprehensive and this may be a little pain since we are doing in local anesthesia, all these pre-medication do tend to help. And always put an oxygen mask or a nasal cannula. Personally, I find that the awake patient is more comfortable using a nasal cannula rather than an oxygen mask. They have a feeling of suffocation with the mask, and that is why I have now switched over to using a nasal cannula. Always have nursing staff present and an intravenous line present, and I never do this procedure without also an anesthetist present in the OR for any emergency which may arise. Have a continuous intraoperative monitoring, an IV line, ECG, SpO2 specially for early diagnosis. Please do not treat it as a casual OPD procedure. Always have all your monitoring in place before you start the procedure. So these are the various approaches which will vary according to the surgeon's specialty, obviously, and training. For the cervical spine, we tend to use the anterior approach, and the transpedicular and lateral approaches for the dorsal and lumbar spine. We will be discussing about these. So in the cervical spine, although it is a little advanced procedure for the beginners, we tend to manually displace the carotid jugular complex and guide the needle insertion into the vertebral body under CM guidance. And then we can inject our cement. So just manually displace the trachea and the esophagus medially and the arteriovenous complex of laterally, palpate the arteries and go in between them. And this is how it can be done. This is one example. And some may even opt to do a esophagogram by barium swallow to see whether they have punctured the esophagus, but this is hardly needed in the routine. So this is what we would focus more on today. It is the thoracolumbar vertebroplasty. We have various approaches which I will be discussing subsequently. So how do you set up this the room, and how do you position this patient? So the patient is to be placed prone on a radiolucent surgical table with easy CRM access and use a high quality imaging CRM. Place the patient prone with the padded rolls and padding of the various pressure points and make the patient comfortable. Please remember that the patient is under local anesthesia and he's aware and awake. And please make the patient as comfortable as possible, because the procedure may sometimes take a little longer, and a comfortable patient tends to fidget a lot less and makes your life really simple while doing the procedure. And also make sure that the patient is lying squared up on the table. And before you start to paint and drape, always check whether your image is proper and your levels are being showed properly. Take a few test shots from the C-arm, localize the vertebral level, and take all these corrective measures of positioning before you start the paint and drape. Use a strict sterile technique. Don't think it is a casual OPD procedure being done under local anesthesia. The patient has to be painted and draped like a proper surgery. So this is the main point. How do you interpret your C-arm images? So this is the ideal view, which is the axial or the canal view, but this is not available to us in the routine C-arm. So we have to extrapolate these lateral and AP projections and guess how the axial imaging would look like. And there are many tips and tricks to it. So this is the main vertebral body, how it looks. And please be aware that when in the lateral position, even though you may be inside, in the AP position, you may be inside the vertebral body. But if you see an axial scan, you may actually be outside the vertebral body, because the anterior of the vertebral body is not a square. It is rounded, and you may actually be projecting outside of it. So you have to be aware and follow these rules very strictly and judiciously. So this is this image has been taken as an example. A radiographic marker or a wire has been tied around the pedicle, and as you can notice, this wire has been put around the waist of the pedicle. That is the narrowest part of the pedicle. So on the AP projection, what you see is the waist of this pedicle and not actually the entry or the base of this pedicle. And this is how it looks in the lateral view. So this is the true AP, which you should always set before trying to proceed. So what is the true AP? You can see the pedicles are in the upper half of the vertebra. They are equidistant from the spinous process. So, and the end plates are parallel to each other. So this is how it is. So these are the pedicles. They are in the upper half of the vertebra. The end plates are parallel to each other. And the spinous process is in the center. This I call the owl view, that you can like the face of an owl, and the eyes are equidistant from the spinous process. So this spinous process is in the center.
Yes.
The process, doctor, for the injection process, however they have an approval or not. If they have an approval, there will be applicable the co-payments. Sometimes 20 dirham, sometimes 10 dirham, 30 dirham, 50 dirham, according to the insurance card.
Yes.
So, even though today I got it without the accuracy, because Sami not connected.
Sorry. Yeah. So, this is the true lateral view.
Before I joined here, they pay more their pockets. There's,
that's superimposed on each other in the true lateral view. And the end plates again are parallel to each other. This is what we should strive at, and this is the flow of the procedure. I will be taking it step by step. So how do you gain access? So this is the basic Jamshidi needle, which you need to use to gain access to the vertebral body. And also the system has this blunt and sharp guide wires. So always remember to use these blunt guide pins rather than sharp, because in the osteoporotic bones, these tend to penetrate the cortex and go out. So normally I do not use these sharp guide wires, but blunt guide wires are to be used. So this is the osteo introducer cannula, so which you exchange over the guide wire, and from this the entire procedure then proceeds to this osteo introducer cannula. So it has the markings, so you don't need to take in the x-rays again and again, and you can judge how far inside you have gone from the mark of the cannula. So these are the two approaches which we tend to use. This is the transpedicular approach through the pedicle. Typically we use it from T10 to L5 level, and it is wide enough to accommodate all your instruments. And then is the extra pedicular approach for the above segments. As you can see that the vertebra is conical, and this transpedicular approach, you may not be able to reach the center of this vertebra here. So that is why we need to go more laterally, and you sometimes use an extra pedicular approach also in cases of tumors, or sometimes when the pedicle is not visible, the pedicle is destroyed due to pathology, you may go on to an extra pedicular approach for the procedure. So this is how you plan the trajectory on the lateral view according to the morphology of this fracture. You can judge that. So this is how you go for the transpedicular access. So you see the landmarks in the AP view, mark the lateral border of the pedicle, and then you go lateral to this. Since you want to lateralize your entry point and go reach the middle, so on the skin you need to be a little lateral to your projection on the x-ray. And in the obese, you need to go a little more laterally. So the skin entry point, there is no hard and fast rule that it should be 1 centimeter or 2 centimeter lateral. You need to judge it according to the patient morphology, and you should move a little more lateral in the obese. So make the skin incision, as you can see, on the more lateral aspect than the lateral border of the vertebra. Then you insert the needle and reach the docking point on the lateral border of the pedicle, and it should be around 9 to 10 o'clock on the left hand pedicle and 2 to 3 o'clock on the right pedicle. And on the lateral view, you should be at the entry of the pedicle at the posterior aspect, and you should be in the center, try to be in the center of this pedicle. So then you advance the needle to the middle of the pedicle, both in the AP view and in the lateral view. This means that you are going into the right direction. Then you advance a little more and reach the middle border of this pedicle, and simultaneously you are at the posterior border of the vertebra in the lateral view. That means your approach is perfect. So this is the axial view of the last step, where you are just entering the posterior border of the vertebral body. And then you go in a little further, exchange your cannulas. So this is how it looks when at point number one, when you are at the lateral margin, you should be at the posterior border, and in the and you can see that you are at the entry of the pedicle. So in the next position, when you have reached the half of the pedicle, then you should be in mid half in the lateral view, and you are in the axial, you are actually in the half of the pedicle again. And at the post, at the when you hit the medial border of the pedicle, you are in the posterior half of the you are just touching the posterior margin of the vertebral body, both in the lateral view, and this is the corresponding axial view. So this axial view is not visible to you. This is just to make your mental image clear what is happening. And once you are inside, and once you reach the tip of the spinous process, you are almost in the anterior part of the vertebral body in the lateral view, and this is the corresponding axial view. So this is what you should be aware of. So if you have almost crossed the medial border, but in the lateral view you have proceeded very little, that means you are too medial and you are breaching the medial wall and you are going into the spinal canal, and you should be changing your trajectory. Similarly, if you have proceeded very little, in the AP view, you have proceeded very little, but in the lateral view, you are almost inside the vertebral body. That means you have perforated laterally and you're proceeding again in the wrong direction, and you should do a recheck of your trajectory and put the needle again. So this is the extrapedicular approach for the higher levels or when the pedicle is not accessible. So as you can see, the regular transpedicular approach may not be adequate in some vertebrae, and you need to take a more lateral extrapedicular approach. So this is how it looks like in the extrapedicular approach. The entry point is at the lateral junction of the transverse process and the superior articular process. It is between the rib and the transverse process at the superior lateral pedicle wall. So this is your entry point. So in the superior lateral corner, this is the entry point for an extrapedicular approach between the rib head and the transverse process. So insert the needle on the lateral wall of the pedicle, costovertebral junction, and it should be located at the superior lateral border of the pedicle in the AP view. And in the lateral view, it should be at the mid pedicle and just at the entry of this pedicle and in the middle of the pedicle. This is the inferior border of the pedicle, this is the superior border, and just in the middle. So this is how you proceed, and once you are in the middle, then you can see once you have reached the middle border, you are at the posterior border of that leg. So this is how it looks. Correspondingly, you start at the upper outer corner, and you are at the entry of the pedicle. This is where you are in the corresponding axial view, and you start going in, you reach the middle of the pedicle in the AP view, you are almost at the posterior border, and then you proceed further at the middle, you are at the posterior border now, and you have just entered the vertebral body. So this is the extrapedicular approach, and once you have crossed beyond the middle border of the pedicle, you are well inside the body, and this is the corresponding axial view to give you an idea where you are. And once you have reached the middle of the spinous process, you are well inside the anterior part of the vertebral body. So next step is to create a channel for the balloon. For this, first I would suggest that you inject some dye and do a venogram. So you inject a contrast through the needle, visualize the vertebral body and epidural paraspinal veins. So this gives you an advantage. It predicts the pattern of the cement injection, and you can be aware of any leakage at this point. So this is the bone biopsy device at this point for especially tumor cases. If you want to take a bone biopsy, you can introduce this bone biopsy needle through the osteointducer channel. And this is the drill which we tend to use to create a channel for the balloon. So these instruments also have consistent markings. So the first marking corresponds that you have just the tip of this osteointroducer or this drill has just reached the tip of the cannula. And then in 1 centimeter increments, you can see the various markings are there. So all these markings, these you should utilize because these tend to reduce your X-ray exposure and you don't need to take repeated X-rays. And you can also attach a needle to this biopsy device and you can aspirate for a biopsy or sending for a histopathology. So this is how it looks like. When we have advanced the instrument halfway, the drill to create a channel for the balloon. So this is how it looks like on the lateral X-ray. And on the AP X-ray, we just reached the tip of the spinous process. So this is another nice instrument which is there in the system, which is the curette, which can again be used to create the channel. It is used best when the inflation of the balloon is undesirable, or it is asymmetric in shape, and you can enlarge the cavity for the balloon, and you can both scrape and score with this curette, which is bendable and can be introduced again through the working cannula. So next step is to place the inflatable balloon tamp. So this is the inflatable balloon tamp which we use, which has a balloon at the tip, and there are two ports, one which is having the stylet and the other is the inflation port. So this inflation port, through which we push in a dye or push in some liquid to inflate this balloon, and this is a stylet to make this entire passage visible under the imaging of the X-ray, and some people tend to remove it. Is an optional thing that after introduction you can remove the stylet. And this is another balloon in the system, which is a unidirectional balloon or a unidirectional balloon tamp, and you can use it in one direction to inflate the balloon and achieve a fracture reduction in that particular plane only. So this is a very intuitive system here. So this is how you place the balloon tamp through the osteointroducer cannula, and the lateral view, you see that the tamp has been introduced, and both these two points should be well inside the bone. So this is the limit of the balloon, basically. So this is how it looks. So these two points are the limit of the balloon. So you know that the entire balloon is well within the vertebral body. So this is how the balloon would be between these two limits. So next step is to inflate this balloon. So we anchor this balloon tamp with 0.5 to 1 cc of contrast to make this balloon visible. And at this point, you may opt to remove this guide wire for some better visualization of the balloon if you find that it is hindering your assessment. So the balloon pressure may reach up to 400 psi, 400 or even up to 700, depending upon the quality and the make of the balloon. And this tends to reduce the fracture. So this control of the volume and the pressure is in the hand of the surgeon. As you inflate the balloon, you should monitor this volume and pressure continuously. So this is how it looks like inside the in the X-ray. This is how the balloon inflates. So what is the end point of this inflation? When your fracture has reduced satisfactorily, when you have achieved the maximum pressure of the balloon, which is indicated by the manufacturer, the maximum volume which you can fill in that balloon, and when your balloon has achieved a cortical bone contact. So stop at that point. So next step is to put in the cement. So this is the vertebroplasty cement. The vertebroplasty cement tends to be a little different from the regular arthroplasty cement in that it is more radio opaque to be more visible under the X-ray, and the work and the setting time is a lot longer. So you have ample working time, and this is for controlled delivery. So I would recommend, please do not use the regular arthroplasty cement. The setting time is very, very short. The radial opacity is not adequate. And if you mix up the dye or a barium sulfate in the arthroplasty cement, the setting time changes. And it becomes a very difficult procedure. The cement starts to harden much more sooner than you anticipate, and the entire procedure becomes chaotic. So it is much more worthwhile to have a dedicated vertebroplasty cement for you rather than the regular arthroplasty cement. The cost difference is not substantial for the headache of the arthroplasty cement, in my opinion. So this is the different bone hardening time. according to the temperature. You can as your OR temperature is around 15, it takes about 40 minutes to harden up to 23 degrees, up to 20 minutes. So you have adequate working time to carry out the procedure rather than being in chaos all the time and being anxious. So this is my tip, how to mix the cement and how to economize this cement usage. What I tend to do is take out the powder of the, so the cement comes in a powder and a liquid monomer, and this is how I do it. So I take out the powder in a 50 ml syringe. So in this example, the powder from that pack is around 40. And similarly, the liquid is in another syringe of 20 ml is around 20 ml. So with this, you can have precise measurements and you can calculate that for 40 milligram of powder, you need around 20 ml, or you need 10 ml liquid for 20 milligram powder. So in this way, you can mix little quantities of cement and use them as per your convenience for multiple levels for procedures, rather mixing all at once and then rushing through the procedure. So there is a short video now of how I do it. So just take out the powder as much as you require, as you anticipate at one level. Maybe at that level you just need a little bit of cement rather than the entire pack. So you can just pour out the amount which you require. The problem is the companies give a whole lot of cement, more than what you require. And if you are doing at multiple level, then if you mix all of them at once, then it becomes very difficult and the procedure becomes very rushed. So this is how I've started now using it. I just take out the quantity which I need of the powder measured and corresponding the amount of liquid which I need. That I pour into the powder, just so that it is measured and adequate. So because if you change these proportions, also your the setting time tends to change. So with this method, you are very, very precise. And then you mix it thoroughly and then you can use it little by little, level by level. So this is another device called the bone filler device, which I tend to use, which you can fill up with the bone cement, and then you can use this tamp of this bone filler device to push in the cement rather than the 2 ml or 5 ml syringes, which do not give adequate pressure or control, and sometimes the stilet tends to break of the syringe. So that is why I have now switched on to using the bone filler device consistently rather than the syringes. And this is another bone filling device which is unidirectional. So if you want to just put in the cement on one side, then you can use this kind of a bone filler device also. But be aware, it may be a little risky. And if you have not, if you have created a cavity like this big, huge cavity, and you have just put in a small cement, your cannula may get, the bone filling device cannula may get locked inside the vertebra. So be aware of all these complications and just constantly rotate so that it doesn't set. So once you mix the cement, when it has reached the toothpaste like consistency, that is the time that it is ready for usage. The cement injection should be meticulous and under fluoroscopic monitoring always. And the liquefied cement is injected when it has reached that toothpaste consistency, then you start injecting. You should inject till the cement reaches the posterior one third of the vertebral body. Posterior one third. And if the cement starts extruding into the epidural or the foraminal or paraspinal veins, you can abandon the procedure. Remember, the patient is awake and you should have a verbal communication with the patient. You can even ask them to move their toes and flex their knees, etc., so that you are not doing any damage. If there is a significant disc space penetration also, you should stop. And ideally, the posterior one third should be filled up with the cement. Inject the cement 0.5 cc at a time under fluoroscopy, little by little, and use the bone filling device tamp to avoid a cement tail. I will show you what that is in some subsequent slides. So typically the vertebra takes 3 to 10 cc of cement, but we should not be bothered about the exact amount of cement which we are injecting, because larger volume may not be the most optimal. Improvement is achieved by use of a lower cement volume but with symmetrical placement, so that your objective of restoration of height etc. is fulfilled, rather than the amount of cement that can be accommodated in that vertebral body. So this is how a completed vertebroplasty looks like. Then patient should remain on the table until the cement is completely hard. It takes about 15 minutes or so, depending upon your OR temperature and the speed with which you have carried out the procedure. It is wise to start a countdown timer in the OR when you are started mixing the cement, so that you can be aware of these times. And you can confirm this hardening by keeping a small ball in your hand. So this is a video I've made of the entire procedure for everyone's benefit, with a small tips and tricks which I'll keep on telling in between. So this video is also available online on YouTube and ViewMedi. So this is a 75-year-old lady with pain in the back who has been bedridden, and you can see an L1 compression fracture. So this, I've given local anesthesia and inserted the Jamshedi needle, and the pedicle has been targeted the way which we have discussed in the previous slides, and it is confirmed in the lateral view. So once we've reached the body, so we know that the cannulation has been successful. So this is how you can exchange with a guide wire. You take out the stilet of the Jamshedi, put a blunt guide wire, because the sharp guide wire may sometimes penetrate the anterior part of the vertebral body and hit the vital structures. So it is better to use a blunt guide wire. And then you can exchange your Jamshedi needle for the working cannula. Remember, at all times the patient is awake and aware, and you can discuss you should have a verbal communication with the patient, and if any complication is arising, you can take corrective measures. So this is the advantage of doing it under local anesthesia. So repeat this on the opposite side. Again, the same steps, the same principles are followed to cannulate the pedicle. This is a video of a transpedicular approach. You can attach your syringe and aspirate the fluid inside. If there is anyone, send it for a culture or any examination or investigation which you want to do. So this is another trick which I use. Inject a little bit of normal saline, and you can see that it pours out of the other cannula like this. And so you are in the vertebral body, and a channel between the two has been established properly. Liquid from one side is coming out of the other side. But please remember to drain this back. You don't want to leave the NS inside, as it may interfere with your cement polymerization. Just aspirate it back. This just step to ensure that it is in the right place. Next, you can inject the radio-opaque dye. This is a good idea to do this, so because it can predict the track your cement will take. But then you need to flush this out with normal saline. Otherwise, this may hinder your radiographic views. This is the balloon tamp which we use. As you can see, So what to economize, what I tend to do is take half dye and half NS mixture, that is a 50-50 mixture. So less dye is used basically, and this makes the cannula visible under X-ray. Without this dye, your cannula will not, this balloon will not be visible under the lateral view. Just load your inflation device with this mixture of liquid, and you can see the bone pan has been advanced inside the vertebral body, and the inflation device is now being attached. And then you can slowly inflate the balloon. You can see on this end, the balloon is being inflated, and you can see the fracture beautifully is getting reduced. The end plates are getting elevated. Once you have achieved your desired height, you can remove this stem and ideally do a bilateral procedure. And if the economics of the thing allows, you can use two balloons at the same time. So, ideal scenario would be to use two balloons at the same time to have a consistent elevation of the nucleus and expansion of the vertebral body. You can see here again the controlled elevation. And again, remember the patient is under local anesthesia, so you may talk with the patient if they are feeling any discomfort or things like that, and you may do the procedure very gradually and then just deflate it and remove. So this is how a bone filler device is used to push in the cement. You can see that the cement is being gradually pushed, and this bone filler device gives you good control as you fill in the vertebral body. So that is why I now switched over of using the syringes. Then I use the bone filler device. It gives more consistent pressure and allows me to fill the bone, the vertebral body, more consistently. You can see from one side the assistant is pushing, and from the other side I am pushing, and in the lateral view there is continuous monitoring on the C-arm. You can do a final confirmation check in AP position. You can see it has well filled up. So this is the good, you can see there is a good restoration of height and filling up of the bone, and the patient is mobile by the next day. So there are certain situations which you should be aware of. If there is cement delivery trouble when you don't have a flow, you just check whether cannula is jammed, clear the cannula with a blunt stylet, and then check for cement flow through the tube of the bone filling device before placing it inside in the body. If you have a thicker cement, it means that your mixing is poor. The room is either hot or humid. And for this, you should ideally store this cement in a refrigerator. And I tend to take it out just before mixing. So the OT tech goes outside the operating theater and gets it from the refrigerator just prior to use. And if the cement still won't transfer, you may have too much dry powder left from the mixing step, and more thorough mixing should be done. So the cement is sensitive to heat and humidity. Store it in a cool, dry place, like I told. So this one complication you should be aware of, that is the pulmonary embolism. The bone cement, especially in the very liquid phase, may go through the venous channel and can enter the systemic circulation. And it is filtered in the pulmonary circulation, 3-4% cases. Most patients may be asymptomatic. And if symptomatic, the patient usually complains of tachypnea or respiratory difficulty. So you just need to monitor this patient, and most patients can be treated with anticoagulant therapy and respond favorably. So like I said, in the monitoring, it is a good idea to put oxygen to the patient and an SpO2 monitor to the patient before the procedure itself. So post-operatively, we dress the site, strict bed rest for 2-3 hours, monitor the vitals, and the neurological examination is done. And then the patient can be discharged 3-4 hours after the procedure if they are well versed and they can follow your instructions, or you may tend to keep the patient overnight in the hospital. Then you can follow the patient next day after 1 week, then a month and 6 months with serial x-rays. And always inform the patient that they need to report immediately if they have a new back pain or a chest pain, if they have lower extremity weakness or have fever more than 100 degrees. So post-operative CT, we don't do routinely. It is best for documentation and location of the cement, especially in cases where there has been substantial leakage during the procedure. You may opt to do a post-operative CT. That is not required routinely. The complications are less than 10%, such as neuralgia, infection, cord compression, pulmonary embolism, urethral fracture, CSF leak, hypotension, increased pain. But if you do the procedure very carefully and judiciously and follow the routes, these should be very, very less. So some pearls and pitfalls. So this is how the cement extrusion can be anteriorly, laterally, and most devastating is the canal extravasation, which you should be careful of. This is how it looks. On the lateral view, it is more apparent. So cement extrusion can be anterior also, and the small amount usually is asymptomatic, but nevertheless, you should be aware of this. Significant leakage, especially in the canal or anteriorly near the vessels, can be quite dangerous. And for that, it is always a good idea to do the procedure under continuous monitoring of the fluoroscope. And this is the cement tail, which I had mentioned earlier. So if you use a too liquid cement and withdraw the cannula too fast, this kind of a cement tail may happen in the musc and in the soft tissues. Mostly it is asymptomatic, but best it should be avoided, and use the cement when it is toothpaste-like consistent. Especially in the case of tumors in myeloma or osteolytic lesions, there is a complete destruction of the posterior cortical wall, and there is an increased chance that the cement may come in the canal. So, and you may even cause tumor migration, or if the cement is not adequately placed, it may push the tumor inside the canal. Not only the cement, the tumor may also get pushed sometimes. So you should be aware of all these pitfalls. And if the anterior wall is deficient, subsequently on loading, the tumor may dislocate anteriorly also. The bone cement may dislocate anteriorly. So this is the utility of regular follow-up, even up to 6 months to a year. So even a delayed dislocation and dislodgement of the cement may happen. So these levels, you should be very well cautious in the upper levels, C7 to T1, T2, T3, which are not well visualized on the CRM. Normally, the leakage into the disc is of no clinical consequence. And in this case, when the cement was allowed to harden in the disc, and then another exchange of cannula was done over the guide wire, and then the body was used and the cement was filled up in the body. So this is a case of severe collapse. You may not have enough cement. 10 ml of cement you may not be able to push in. So the height of the vertebral body is a better guide than the amount of cement which you can push in. So this is the eggshell technique. Sometimes when the cement is leaking, you should just put in a small amount of cement, let it harden, and fill up the defect so that the cement does not leak. And then you can fill it in stages, the same vertebral body. This is called the eggshell technique, especially helpful in the tumor conditions. So this is another case, burst fracture of the L1. And then percutaneously the screws were also put, and then they were removed after 18 months. So the future of this, some developments are still on the cards, such as the calcium phosphate for use in the young patients. And then prophylaxis of tumors by adding a chemotherapeutic agents. These are mostly of theoretical concern these days. So this is my protocol, which I use for this vertebroplasty or kyphoplasty for fractures less than 6 weeks. And if the vertebral body height is not too bad, then I tend to go in for a vertebroplasty or and in tumor cases. But in cases of compression fracture is there, and I normally use a kyphoplasty to restore the bone height. Vertebroplasty is cheaper and is quicker. And kyphoplasty, although it is a little more expensive, it takes a little longer, but there is a restoration of vertebral height much better with kyphoplasty, and less chances of adjacent fractures and less cement leakage. These are some studies which were done, and in which kyphoplasty has come out better than vertebroplasty. Again, another meta-analysis, the same, and you can see in the cement leakage, also balloon kyphoplasty fares much better than plain vertebroplasty. So even in adverse events were much less with balloon kyphoplasty as compared to vertebroplasty. So in conclusion, it is a minimally invasive procedure. The surgical technique may be acquired in a short time. It can be performed in an outpatient basis and under local anesthesia. You may combine it with the screws, and the short and long term results are encouraging. But please remember, it is a procedure with inherent risks, and without appropriate preparation and physician knowledge, can quickly produce increased pain, permanent neurological injury, and even death. So please treat this procedure with respect and do it carefully. And thanks for a patient hearing. So now the session is open for questions and discussions.